back now with our classical night, or as Jonathan called it, the games you need to know by heart. So I would call it classics because, as I always talk, we care a lot about our heuristics, and I still maybe sound a little bit old-fashioned. Our brain works in its way, and artificial intelligence works its own brute force way. That's how I would distinguish. So we need themes, we need modules to be able to craft our own ideas. And I think that looking at the games of the best, the ones that in which one can actually clearly show a plan helps us a lot. So one thing, when I choose these games, I really try to pay attention to two things. First, there is a well-crafted plan with a lot of finesse being executed, and it's not messy. I really care about that, not showing things that is messy. And that's why choosing a game from contemporary players is much harder, because you look at Capablanca against his opponents, there's a huge difference between Capablanca and his opponents. They're maybe like 300 points, and they're like maybe the player next to him in the tournament. So it's hard nowadays to find such games, but I managed to actually find a game from 2012 played between Anish Giri, famous Dutch Grandmaster, number one Dutch Grandmaster and top 10 player. He was here, I think, a couple of times, or I don't know, every single cup. And Alexander Morozevich, known for his flamboyant style, very original player, playing Chigoring and all the risky stuff. He's very reckless when it comes to his principles. He can go all the way, not caring about the result, but staying truthful to his beliefs and the way he plays chess. Anyways, this is a rapid game from 2012. And last week we talked about a trap piece, and then how we can use the piece that is not being trapped, our own to execute an attack. Today, this game is about attacking an uncastled king, especially when your opponent takes your gambit. So it's about attacking an uncastled king. So let's start. So d4, knight f6, c4, e6, knight f3, d5, g3. What's this, the name of this opening? Catalan. So the idea is that I want to place my bishop on g2 and prepare this thrust e4 at some point. And this bishop will become a very strong piece. And I'll maintain a small center. I call this a perfect center, d4, e4, and I call this c4, d4 a small center. It's the naming I use. It's small center usually is called the pawn when it's e6, d6, or e3, d3. But I call it this, I don't know what to call it, side center or a minor center, I don't know. But and then using the extra space. And if this d takes c4 happens, then this bishop becomes strong, and there's a famous game, another classical, Smyslov against O'Kelly. O'Kelly, Belgian grandmaster of old days, and Smyslov, of course, world champion. That it shows the strength of this bishop. So because in queen's gambit lines, when this bishop comes along this diagonal, again it ends up after the exchange going to c4, and again it's just biting the ground. Just, you know, this pawn is on e6. Hardly you can create something more. The development is faster. You bring your pieces faster in the queen's gambit, but in Catalan, you preserve that right, that preserve the chance that maybe that my bishop becomes a very strong piece. Okay, he actually took on c4, bishop g2, b5. That sounds crazy. Wow, you're voluntarily weakening the diagonal. White plays a4 first. That's a very important one, because if knight e5, it actually would transpose, but knight e5, I think, we give an extra chance of c6. And you might say, what is that? Don't you lose an exchange? But after takes, bishop takes, and bishop d7, I am not sure if this is a very good line, but I know that black has some compensation. Given this was a rapid game, maybe, you don't believe that?
No, listen, I wouldn't want to be black.
I mean, I'm not sure if e5 right away would work, because now we have a threat, but probably not, because after, I'm not sure, actually, after take, what's going on here? Something's going on. Something's going on. So, king here, and then knight to g4. Maybe it works, actually. So, black will have some extra chances. So that's why white first plays a4. Because now if b4, what happens? No. Now knight d5. And if I go knight d5, what happens now?
E4.
Oh, well, e4 is a fine move. But how about just we just grab this pawn back? Better pawn structure, and we preserve e4, and that he can, black cannot stop. So because of that, now I'm forced to play c6, which is really ugly, but still. Knight e5, now I really want to take on c6. Knight e5 stops, castle, and a6. Now I'm going to challenge you to a certain good amount of time, and see if you can find white's idea in this position. You are not going to bring back your pawn soon. In fact, you should kind of consider it as gone. But you got black has weakened his position, and he's behind a lot of tempi in terms of development. How should white uncork an attack that would keep black's king in the center? It's.
I'll do e4 first.
Yeah, but that was very good. A takes b5, c takes b5, and then b3. This is very important because now this e4, d5 becomes extremely critical, opens up the game, becomes extremely explosive. So, black, this bishop b7, e4, knight f6, and now, how do you continue the attack? Bishop g5, I mean, I can take on d4. That's one consideration, right? If you go bishop to g5, I can take on d4. Or I can go bishop e7. I just need one tempo to get my king to safety. You cannot afford...
Knight takes f7, and king takes f7, and d5, potentially.
That's an interesting one. That's very interesting, but... After e takes d5, I don't see what the, how exactly can you.
Look d1 first.
Could be a bit slow. I mean, first of all, e4 is hanging. But even if not because of e4, bishop e7. I understand you want to push d5, but if you push d5 and I'm already castled, you might have maximum compensation, not more than that.
How about bishop a3?
Bishop a3, I take.
Then the queen takes,
so
you can't castle. You still lose d4.
D4 is hanging, that's right. Mm. And also, if I play even queen e7, I'm just trying to be a queen. If I just make normal moves, Think about it this way. If I just make normal moves, you have to find a way to keep my king in the center. Otherwise, you are a pawn down, and I'm going to castle my king. So to keep my king in the center...
What about center. Bishop h3?
Interesting idea.
Yeah.
You're realizing that the weakness is on e6, but it's a bit... It's too much. Yeah. What's that?
D5.
Open up the center, but you have to see what is happening. Mm-hmm. If I take e takes d5, what is going on here? First of all, you had to see what is going to happen after bishop d6, which is going to be the main line we're going to look at. But what about e takes d5?
Rook d1.
Rook d1. Bishop d6. I think that now, my friend, you are facing some difficult questions. But it's a good start. D5, he takes D5 here.
What about Knight takes f7.
That's interesting. E5, maybe, because there, I don't have knight to e4. But if I go knight e8, I don't see how exactly we are going to. I see your idea, but I don't see how we can continue because it's sort of a colossal loss of material.
Right. Okay.
Can we minimize the loss and keep going with the same idea?
What about just rook e1?
Interesting. Interesting. I go bishop e7. Castle.
Yeah, you gotta play active a lot of times.
Well, play active, exactly. You have to play active.
So pawn takes pawn. What about pawn takes pawn?
Bishop takes pawn.
Okay.
To win a tempo, threats are the key to win a tempo. If you can create a threat, you can win a. You can win a tempo. So bishop takes d5 and e takes d5, bishop d5. What has happened after d5? What's the biggest achievement we have after d5? E takes d5, e takes d5.
Rook e1.
Well, you don't want to give a queen.
Queen's gone. Bishop takes first, then he can take with either knight or queen.
Well, I'll take with the queen because I want to exchange material as much as possible. Okay. Any other opinions? I'm sure if I make the move, you'll see it. He takes d5. Bishop takes d5. So the e-file has opened up. We opened up the e-file and d-file. That's a lot of open files. That's exactly the answer.
Yeah.
Because after queen e3, bishop e7, what happens now? The second file.
Rook d1.
Rook d1. And this pin is a killer.
Yeah.
Knight c3 is coming. I'm going to win some material here sooner or later.
Mm-hmm.
Are we good?
No.
Questions? Make sense? Mm-hmm. So this d5, ed5, ed5, given that, ed5, given that this knight is jumping to c6, rook is coming here, this is a dangerous position. So black didn't enter here, enter that, played bishop to d6. Now here we have three interesting moves. It doesn't take...
Pawn takes...
Pawn takes pawn. Okay. This is good. Both knight f7, there are some subtle issues with it we will see later.
Okay.
Well, I mean, it's not an issue, but makes it a bit more complicated. DE6 leads to a clear-cut winning position for white that we are going to discuss. Knight f7 should lead to that, but it's more complicated. There's another good move here, knight c4. That's also a nice move. I want to take and bishop on a3 and bishop on f4 and e5 and d6 also. That's also. This is the positional way of winning. Because knight also goes to a5. Way too many threats in this position. So now let's follow this one. D take e6. So bishop takes knight. E takes f7. Check. And I go king f8.
Bishop to a3 now.
Bishop a3. Check. Bishop to d... but then it's game over. Rook d1, bishop d5.
I can't be good.
No, I mean, you can take with the rook, take and queen takes, that's winning.
Yeah.
I'm just trying to understand what is the right move here. So d take e6. Because I know there's some e5 in this position. So if I take, you take check. Okay, I go king e7. Because now, if check, now I go bishop d6. But I think this is the same thing. It has the same fate. I think this is the same. e5 is completely game over. Okay, this is game over. So what was this? Ah, okay. Right, this is winning. This is all game over. Bishop e5, bishop e5, yes. This is just simple. And then rook d1. What I forgot actually to mention is that this move is actually playable, but it's very difficult for human to play this position. That is either this move or the strongest one is actually knight d3, I think. But knight c4 is human move, and it's not a human move. And this is a huge advantage.
Knight d3?
Yeah, not
so counterintuitive,
you're thinking. Yes, yes.
Rook d1?
Or rook d, oh, sorry, rook d, yeah, rook, oh, sorry, actually, rook d1, you're right, there, and now knight d3. This is very counterintuitive. This is impossible for me. Yeah. For me, this one is impossible for me to play.
Yeah.
I've analyzed this position several times. Whenever I get here, I still have to double check to make sure, because it's so counterintuitive for me to play it. Maybe I've analyzed this position at least 25 times. And then whenever I get to this position, I still have to double check this to make sure, because it just doesn't make sense to me. Every time I get it. I'm pushing e5. I'm pushing
e5.
I'm pushing e5, threatening to playing e5. Yeah, there's a fork here.
Right.
I mean, for example, if you play e5, I can just take it. And if you take with the bishop, bishop a3, the queen has nowhere to go. It's impossible to see it. The queen has nowhere to go. Because if queen f7, we have rook d8 check.
Yeah.
And if queen anywhere else, I have this deadly check on e6.
C7?
Queen e6 checkmate. And if queen takes, bishop goes to f4, I give the rook, but this is now, again, the checkmate follows up. So you the counterintuitive part is that after, I mean, it says first, I have to first take on d6, because the queen checks, there's bishop e7. Take, and the check cannot be prevented. That's game over. And the king has already moved, so there's no castle or something that can be trick or something. So the thing is that, this is so, you have to see, there's no e5. And now this e5 cannot be stopped. It's impossible. I mean, when I think about it, this is impossible to think about it. Because knight c6 also, there's e5, right? I mean, every time okay, this one I didn't forget. Good, after 25 times. After e5, knight takes e5, and then yes, this is winning, yes. Awesome. Because queen takes and then check. Or do I have to first take on e5, or maybe I have to first take here, queen e7, take, king takes, and then I can go rook e1 and win the piece.
If knight
f4.
Yeah. Oh,
f4,
yeah.
F4. Well, I mean, if you give me the position, this one, I can find that. This position, if you give me this one, I can. If you give me this position and say play rook d1, knight d3, I cannot find it. It's just so counterintuitive to me to play knight d3. If you tell me what knight f7, I would just play, if you give me this position and say play knight f7, d e6, e5, comes immediately to mind. But this is just like, yeah, well, but this is beautiful. I mean, if you think about the idea is very beautiful. This rook d1 there and knight d3, e5 is not defendable. Well, anyways, knight f7. I understand this. Yeah, I mean d take e6 because okay, obviously we should look at this also. F takes e6, queen e6 doesn't get anywhere, of course. Just this, and you have to exchange queens, and your initiative fizzles out in few moves. It's gone. I mean. 0.6 is good advantage actually he was giving, but still, nothing compared to what you can actually get. But I understand this move. This one I understand. Comes with a check, king e8, and e5. e5, bishop takes, and now he takes f6. Why this works? Why this move works? Why can't I take on f1? And rook g8, e7, yeah. And that's deadly. And if I take, of course, you have to add that there's this check. Yeah. Big time.
The truth hurts.
As Ben Feingold, yeah. So, because of that, I cannot take, so I have to take on f6. Now this is a strong move, king takes g2. Now material is even. If I'm not going to grab this rook on a1, I am lost. I am lost. Because the king has already moved, there's no castle, this pawn is right up there, and this pieces are jumping just, so if I don't grab, I'm lost. First of all, I forgot to mention, what about bishop takes c5?
I like rook a4.
Rook a4, okay, that is a bit, I think bishop takes bishop. It's a bit artificial. Knight c4 is, yeah.
Rook to d1.
Yeah, I play queen c7. I mean, we are a piece down right now. We are trying to win back our material.
But rook takes.
Can you still play e7?
E7 now?
I think.
Bishop takes bishop, rook a7.
What about rook takes a6? If rook takes a6, then you have.
If rook takes a6, then I take on g2.
No.
Oh, sorry. No, I take on a6 with the bishop.
Bishop.
And when you take, you are still.
A8.
Yeah, but you are still a piece down.
Yeah.
I mean, you might have something actually still there, even there, but you are a piece down. It's an interesting idea. It's actually, you're getting close to the actual answer. Bishop takes bishop, rook a7. That's it. Yes. Rook here, and then bishop takes a7. Well, also the important thing is that what hurts big time is that after bishop takes here, check, and then bishop a3, that hurts. That's the truth, and that hurts big time. And that king is exposed. I mean, you cannot bring your rook to the game. I bring my pieces, and that should be end of it. Although, this check is enough. Yeah, that's enough. Yeah, I was thinking maybe first rook d1, but I don't need that. I know this is winning. So yeah, that is what it is.
And if bishop takes a1,
that's bishop a1, bishop b5 check.
Instead of rook a7.
Well, then I take here, and you cannot castle, and I'm playing bishop a3, e7 next, and that bishop is a strong, and yeah, the bishop, the pawn on e7 hurts too, that we can add to the truth. So e5, takes, there, queen takes a1, bishop b2, of course. Well, obviously, queen a5 doesn't make sense, now queen a4. How do you continue as white?
Queen
f3 is what he played in the game and actually gives some chance for white. Well, the idea is correct. And the chance, actually, Morozevich didn't find it in this game. And I didn't find it when I was training myself, but there is a chance.
What about queen d5?
D5 is this square, yeah. D5. Because now I am forced to play queen c4. I take on a queen c6 check. Let me show you. Because now I cannot go queen c2, because I can just, I think, take on g7, and still everything is hanging. So queen c4 I have to go, and then after takes check, I can take and take on g7, and this f-pawn is going to be very strong. I mean, the pawns are going to roll. Maybe I first play f4 actually after take. Then let me just check that I cannot recall this one. Yes, actually I can, let me just see it, queen d5, queen c4, yes, takes, check, takes, I don't take on g7, I play f4 first. And after queen, now I take, because now if rook g8, I play f5. And that is winning. But the point is that queen f3 gives an extra chance, that an additional chance that he didn't find, that is queen c2. Because first of all, if I take on a8, I'm not forced, the queen is not on c4, so I can take on b2. And if I go queen f7, we don't have much, because rook d1, there's no rook d1, and after bishop, yes, check, let's say f3 or whatever, rook e8, if I play f3, I don't have rook d1, do I? I still have rook d1, because if check, I go king h3. If you take, I have bishop f6 check, I think. Does it work? But anyways, I think king g1 makes more sense. Rook here, and then there's knight d7. And it's unclear. It's a whole new game. So it gives this extra chance, queen c2, but it's very hard to find, because it's, I call it geometry. I'm not sure if it's the right term for it, but it's sort of extra, we add an extra geometry here, because now queen c2 exists.
D5 is definitely better for queen.
Yeah. But the idea is the same, but you see, you just add one extra chance that it just changes the same. Yeah. I mean, this game was, Anish Kir played it to the perfection. The rest of this game before and even this point, just it's a pity that, I mean, he still won the game, but
it's a rapid game. It's amazing.
Yeah, well, you can be sure up to d take e6 king g2 he might have had it analyzed before. Well, I mean, I trust these guys' intuition and strength. I played against them, I analyzed with them, with Anish Giri specifically, I mean, 2014, and the amazing amount of knowledge and things they know. But I having this degree of brilliance in a rapid game, he should have at least an idea of how he's going to conduct his attack, at least. He just didn't come up with it at the board. I guarantee that to you. And actually, I have a lot of respect for this preparedness, because this is just like so hard nowadays, going straight forward. I mean, I had such a clean win like this in a US Chess League two years ago, but having a clean win like this, maybe it's been years for me. It's really hard to out prepare. So this is just out preparing Morozevich, because I'm sure Morozevich had to look at this position too. So out preparing him like this is just amazing. So now comes rook c1. Obviously, I'm gonna give that check, and after king, okay, let me close this, we don't need it anymore. After king d8, what's happening? You have a handful number of wins here.
Mm-hmm. That's really nice.
That's nice. That's elegant, yeah. Queen check, knight d7, and now the easiest, most elegant way to win. I can't take with the rook, because if you give a check, my rook goes.
Yeah.
You have the idea. Just,
yeah.
What do we have here? This queen on a4 is completely disengaged from the rest. I mean, It doesn't do anything. You just have to keep the jumps.
Bishop
e5 might do it as well. Just d4, attack the rook too, huh? Yeah. The rook has nowhere. And now rook c7, if that's the move. Rook c7, now you drop the queen on a8 and checkmate.
Yeah.
And that's it.
Wow.
Simple.
That's beautiful. Okay.
I love simplicity in chess. It's just so... It's like Mozart. Simple. Deep. Simple, but in the meantime, deep. Very nice win. And I like this for uncastled king, because nowadays you don't see that often happens. You open every YouTube video, or you go on Chess 24 or whatever. Okay, I shouldn't talk about other on camera, but just okay. Or on all the other websites, they have it. And now I mentioned one, I should mention all of them. Or the videos we have from the club, or other existing ones. Everybody talks about bring your pieces to the center, castle, look at your watch your opponent's threat. So finding gems like this, in my opinion, really are things. So I really like this game. So next one is another kind of gem. Okay, first I want to go drop back all the way, 1909. So from 2012, we drop back all the way. Okay, this is a game I... because next game is kind of about defense and attack both at the same time. Is that another game I put there? Yeah, it's about the castled king, and because we talk about defense there, so I wanted to drop you to kind of toss the idea of how to do active defense. So I don't want to cover the whole game. When you look at Kasparov's my great predecessors, the analysis is just this is bad, this is bad, this isn't as great as it seems. So I don't want us to go over and see how bad Rubinstein or Lasker played, but I want to show you this end game, beautiful end game, and the idea how to defend this position.
Rubinstein.
Yeah, he was amazing. He in my opinion was the strongest, couldn't become a world champion. I mean, okay, Korchnoi was almost there, Karas was there, a lot of these guys, but I think Rubinstein was at some point during the First World War was really much stronger than Lasker. Again, my personal opinion, of course. So castle rook here. Now, Black has immediate threat of playing rook takes e3. D4 is hanging as well. Are you going to defend passively, or are you going to come up with some good idea to defend here? So this is about active defense. In surprisingly two moves, Rubinstein dismantles Lasker. Oh, well, I would say three, actually. Well, the first one follows, like, it has an immediate follow-up, and then...
Well, white has a pawn, so he could always trade off queens by doing queen of g4 check.
Well, I can grab the pawn on d4, and then I have two rooks in central files, and I have a bishop over knight, which is a huge advantage as well. After queen g4, actually, take knight. First of all, that pair is the mate. That's good. But gives a huge positional advantage to Black.
Well, the extra pawn, if that's gone, it's a symmetrical pawn structure.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So what about immediately d5?
D5 does a better job than queen g4, but it's still you only achieve equality.
Okay.
You know, that's not... Okay, again, this is a...
Rook c1. Rook takes e3, rook takes c6.
B takes c6.
And then you can capture at e3, then queen takes, and then you lose both your center pawns.
Yeah. You're almost there. First of all, rook c1 is threatening to play rook c5 and d5. So I have to take on e3.
Right.
But this is the beauty. This is the absolute... I remember I was 15 and I first saw this position. I was stunned. I was so happy when I... Queen c1.
That's the famous move. I've seen this game. Yes. Amazing.
such a strong, and it's very funny. Rubinstein beat both last Grand Capablanca playing Queen C1.
Yeah.
Actually, the best game of Rubinstein, if you the old version of which one was the one was published, is there was a board and the Queen C1 move on it. Beat both because in his first game against both Lasker and Capablanca, he both won with Queen C1. You'll see that one next week, actually.
He resigned, right?
Oh, no, he didn't resign. It's a, long, yeah, it's just the beginning. So he took on D4. Actually, Lasker played. You know, I shouldn't say that. We cannot really appreciate the old days amount of calculation for some reason. I don't know. Well, now there are better books, everything. We are more sophisticated. There's more ideas we're aware of. But this one is very accurate in terms of calculation, this one. And both by both players. The position is winning. But the way... Okay, f takes e3, rook d7, queen c6, king here. And now... It is still not clear. If you give a check, I go king e7. If you give a check, I go back to d8. e3 is still hanging. And if the queens go off the board, that rook jumps to d2 faster. So this still could... The ensuing endgame may be a slight draw, but this next one move is just, it's just amazing, impeccable.
E4, it's almost
essential. Well, queen e4, that's okay. I mean, I can go g6, maybe. I mean, you want to go check, I go back to e7. I probably can play g6, and then my plan is going to be queen c5, f5. I mean, you're a pawn up, no question about that.
Yeah.
But you can force a winning endgame here. Well, another reason about this game was that it was the first game, well, I wouldn't say the first game, one of the first games that it started to teach me that there are things ingrained in my head that, for example, now I see the second rank is weak, I don't want to move my rook from the first rank. But the move is here, rook f4.
Oh, wow.
And I am combining my rook is going to move across the horizon along the fourth rank, and I have a threat of giving check on a8, playing rook e4 check.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And my back rank is just fine, and nothing's happening on the second rank. But I see the checks, and I just say, I'm not going to move my rook anyways. Ever. That kind of, it's just there. Just you
Sorry.
Never...
Yeah.
And rook f4, the thing is that if I give a check, king there, if you give a check, king here, and if you go queen g2, then rook d4 check, king here, rook d7 check. Actually, this is checkmate. This is checkmate, sorry. But even I had this move too.
Right,
this is fine. The deflection is beautiful. So because of that, and now I have this queen a8 check, so black had to do something, play the 5. So there was also queen a5, but check, queen c6 check, this is mate is following. And now queen, at least queen d7. Because there's no queen e1 checkmate. Amazing, this rook f4 is really... So f5, queen c5 now, I'm threatening to give this check there and grab the second pawn also. I'm attacking the f5 pawn. The queen is kind of cut from the game. Still this rook d1, check, king e1. I still have the same story. If rook checks, there, check here. And if check here, okay, I have to do this check, but I'm sure, okay, I don't have any more rook d4 check. Anyways, this should be winning too, I was thinking. Yeah, there's no more queens engaged to the fact, but there's this check, queen a5, queen takes d2. It's very funny. I've never actually paid attention to this check after that. I always paid attention to the first one, this one, if you give check, but after f5, I never paid attention, actually. It's interesting. So, queen c5. Black's king is weak, so he has to cover himself. Queen e7. Now how do you play this? Now it's all yours. Almost. Okay, queen takes queen, king takes queen. Okay. Why you don't collect the pawn on f5?
So,
why don't you collect?
Yeah, why not? Yeah.
But then rook d1 check.
Right.
And?
That is perpetual.
I go rook d2, rook b1, and even your two pawns up, that is probably a
draw.
But you play king f2, and that's the subtle things. I like it. You give back one of the pawns. And now rook goes to a5. Both attack and defense at the same time.
Right.
Rook b7 and rook a6. Just cut it off.
That's right.
Now I just go forward.
Yeah.
Just going, yes.
Yeah.
Is that how it ended?
So the end is that now I start pushing my pieces, my pawns. At some point, one of these pawns, h or g, will move. And that gives me a hold either on g6 or f6, and I'm going to use it. I mean, finally, if otherwise, I'm going to play h6 myself. King f5, there, e5, rook b7. And there are many ways not to win. For example, one way is to play maybe e6, king g6, somewhere g5. e6, and then king goes to g6. Sorry, I sometimes speak too fast and unclear. E6, and then king goes to g6, and then g5 at some point, because the rook comes, like the rook comes back to b, comes down to b4, trying to, you know, kind of bother us through behind check, and then, but you have g5 there. But he just went for a3. He went for rook d6, king a7, and okay, he repeated once, and then I don't know why he repeated again, and a3. And now it's six long. His idea is that if rook goes here, I go here. If I go here, now it goes check. I get this end game. And that hole I was talking about on g6 now.
Yeah, it's beautiful. That's a great line. That is.
Yes. And if something else, I don't know, is there anything else? Yeah. Yeah, but apart from that idea, this king g6 should win too, or here Kasparov gives, and now rook d7.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's some of the lines, if you put the king on g6, should win as well. Cannot recall. It's more winning that it looks, but there is still a little bit of subtlety in there.
Sure.
Next week I try to have this game. Anand against Vashi Lagrov, that's a castle king attack. And I'll have Rubinstein against Capablanca. That one is a very classic endgame that has also a lot of historical implications. It's Rubinstein Capablanca.
Oh, yeah.
That's the first tournament Capablanca played in Europe, the major tournament he played, and he won.
So who? At that tournament, nobody knew about Capablanca yet.
Yeah, it was San Sebastian in 1911. And only because of Marshall, everybody accepted to let Capablanca play in the tournament. And like everybody who went from America or West Hemisphere to Europe, like Morphy and Pillsbury, he won his first tournament there. Because Pillsbury, Marshall, and Morphy, whenever they went to Europe, they won their first tournament there. It caused a lot of
angst.
Angst. Yeah, so as a fourth, okay, he was Cuban, but the fourth person from the Western Hemisphere, the New World, went there and he won a tournament. So we will cover those two games, and if we'll have more time, we will keep going with the we will move to Batvinnik, because that will be my last class next week on the classics. Thank you.
Thank you.